You are watching Apocalypse and the End Times on God TV. I'm your host, Paul McGuire, and we're going to talk about Bible prophecy and the importance of Bible prophecy in the Word of God. My special guest is Doug Stauffer, author, speaker, debater on Bible prophecy topics, and extremely well known. And as a side note, I don't know how many times he's been hit by a car or hit by a train, but you've survived it all.
Right.
Give us, just quickly tell us how you got hit by a train.
Well, I was in Baltimore on the phone. It was, you know, speakerphone, and I turned down the road. I'm sitting at a red light, and I'm waiting for the light to turn. Evidently, it all turned red because I wasn't supposed to be there. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden, I could hear out of my window and see it just whomp, and there's a train coming. I just turned the wheel, floored it, and about that time, I'm hit, knocked to the curb. You know, I'm dazed, and I just said, and I could put my hand out the window and touch the train. It stopped also.
You could put your hand out the window of your car and touch the train?
It hit my mirror like it shaved a piece of cheese off the mirror. That's how close I was. And then it hit the tire. When I turned the tire, that's what knocked me to the curb. So it's amazing. You know, it's just one of those things where God protected me. I stayed there for a little while, and then I just put it in reverse and left because nobody was coming out to check on me. So I left.
So you've had other things like this, and what? Just give us the spiritual lesson from this.
Well, I think it's to number your days. That, you know, you don't know what tomorrow holds. Mm-hmm. That, you know, I think it really, that one did affect me. I mean, I've been in a bus that flipped over with 50 preachers on it. I've been three times we caught on fire in two different cars, three different times. And, you know, it's amazing how God protects you. So God has His supernatural hand of protection. And what we've got to do is figure out, all right, what is our purpose, plan, and, you know, how do we please God? How do we serve Him? And that's what I look at in those instances, because they were some supernatural events that happened that when I consider them, it's just amazing that I'm still alive.
Well, I thank God for you and what we're going to get into. But as I said before the cameras started rolling, I will not be riding in any vehicle you're in.
You're not the only one.
But I praise God for His supernatural protection in your life. And speaking of supernatural protection, your book, Reviving the Blessed Hope of Thessalonians. Tell us, many people know what is meant by the Blessed Hope. Just quickly define the blessed hope, because that is supernatural protection.
Sure it is. The blessed hope is when Christ comes back for the church prior to Daniel's 70th week. Daniel's 70th week is Israel. It's Jerusalem. It is not the church. The church, you know, we're the bride. We're ambassadors. God's going to call home His ambassadors before He has all-out war with this earth. Daniel's 70th week is all Israel, and therefore the pre-tribulation rapture is the only truly doctrinal eschatological position that anybody can take. It's not mid-trib, it's not pre-wrath, it's not post-trib, it is pre-trib, and that's it. And that's what I am. That's what that book covers.
Now, tell me what you really think. Okay, so I speak at a lot of Bible prophecy conferences, and I was at a conference a while back, and I met a gentleman who was involved in a debate with you over this whole thing, the timing of the rapture. And he was just as passionate, as intense as you are. He's absolutely convinced that the rapture is going to occur at the end of the tribulation. And for those of our viewers that may not know what the tribulation period is, that's debatable, but let's just say for today's discussion, it's that seven-year time period where God's wrath is poured out on the earth in judgment. There's the debate, will the church be here in the middle of the tribulation? Or as Doug strongly believes and advocates, the church will not be here at the tribulation. It will be raptured before the seven-year tribulation period begins. But this other gentleman, who he's a strong minister. He loves the Lord. In fact, I will say this. I know a lot of very well-known major Christian leaders who love the Lord, and you would know their names. Some of them are household names in the Christian community. But they have different positions in the rapture. Some are mid-trib, post-trib. I know it gets confusing. pre-wrath, and some don't even believe in tribulation. So you have done some debates with people. What, give us, you're the an advocate of the preacher. First of all, give us a couple of sentence definition, for those that may not know it, of what the pre-tribulation position is.
Well, basically, that just means that we're not going to be here for that 7 years of Daniel's 70th week. If you go to Daniel 9, there's...
Excuse me for one second. So that means...
That's the tribulation period.
Okay, so that means the church, all true believers in Jesus Christ, not just people who call themselves
Christians. Right, the body of Christ.
The body of Christ will not be here when the Antichrist is revealed.
Absolutely. Okay. That is the key substance of the matter.
Okay, so go ahead.
So what in relation to that, there are four or five different things that are confusing in the Scripture. Matthew 24, which is the Olivet Discourse, what happens is...
The signs of the times.
Right. They teach and say that that applies to the church. But when you go through and you analyze it verse by verse, you see that that period of time isn't even a rapture. It's not even a catching out. This is what it says in Matthew 24, 29 through 31. He shall send his angels to gather the elect. The elect is the nation of Israel, believers at that time. He's going to gather them together for supernatural protection. When he comes back in Revelation 19 with the armies behind him, they're going to be protected because he's going to send his angels in advance to protect them. That's not the church. It's not a rapture. That's one of the main things that's misunderstood in this whole scenario. Then you have Thessalonians, which is what my book covers.
Right.
You have 1 Thessalonians 5, which is misunderstood, and 2 Thessalonians 2. 2 Thessalonians 2 is the most misunderstood one because they don't realize that it covers the whole seven period.
Tell our viewers what 2 Thessalonians 2 says.
Well, 2 Thessalonians 2 talks about the mystery of iniquity, you know, doth already work. You know, right. Only he who now letteth will let until be taken out of the way, and then the wicked one's revealed. In other words, the Antichrist is revealed in that passage of Scripture. Well, the problem is people don't realize that it covers the whole seven-year period, so they don't distinguish between what's going on. You know,
that passage you referred to.
2 Thessalonians 2 covers the whole 7 years.
All right.
And if you miss that, then you miss the whole import of the verse, the whole import of the passage. That's what we do in that book, is we cover that and show that 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, how it's laid out. The next one's 2 Thessalonians 1, and that's misunderstood because it goes from the present tense to past tense to future tense, and it doesn't tell you when it does it. So you've got to look at it and analyze it. So that's what we do. And then 1 Thessalonians 5 is the same type thing. So when you look at Thessalonians, 1 and 2 Thessalonians, those two books are the major books talking about the future times, the prophecy, the Antichrist, all those things. So if you don't get those two books right, then you're going to be messed up in all your understanding of what's coming in the future.
Now, going back to Jonathan Edwards, the father of the first Great Awakening, he didn't believe, did he not believe in a tribulation? I don't think he believed in a literal thousand-year millennium.
Right.
Did he believe in a, and I don't think he believed in a literal seven-year tribulation period.
He didn't, and let me tell you what's going on.
Okay.
Daniel is a closed book until the time of the end.
Right.
That's where we are today. So unless you get Daniel, I've called it Daniel's 70th week, we've mentioned it's the tribulation.
Right.
Unless you get Daniel straight and understand how it works out, and you don't, up until the end, the time of the end, it's not going to be an open book. So it's an open book today. So we can go in and understand the illumination of the revelation, meaning we understand, here's the revelation, it's all in this book, every bit of it. But the illumination isn't there until you get into the period of time where God says, all right, now I need my church, my people, to understand. And that's where we are today.
Okay, so you're saying that God is supernaturally opening his word to his people in this hour.
Absolutely.
Now, spiritual truth, I mean, that's applicable in all areas. I mean, I know people who are mid-tribulation people, pre-wrath people, post-tribulation people, many of them nationally known ministers, who believe in this, for lack of better words, concept that you're talking about, which is, in the last days, there's special revelation that God has reserved for the last days. I know people that are heavy mid-trib, post-trib people who believe that, you know, God's pouring out all this supernatural revelation that He stored up for the last days. So they've embraced that, but for some reason, when it comes to Daniel, they don't embrace it.
No, they don't. And what is going on is this. I'll tell you my personal story.
Okay.
Years ago, I prayed and said, Lord, if I need to be post-tribulation, I mean, if I need that to be that because I don't have the answers.
Wait, you went to the Lord.
And I asked Him, I said, Lord, I don't understand. I don't have the answers.
Right.
And I really, truly want them.
Right.
And I from that point forward, mm-hmm. every day has been a ride. It's like just a roller coaster, you know, straight down, you know, just going like right. 50 miles an hour. And what's going on?
But why? Why?
Because He answered my prayer.
How quickly did He answer your prayer?
I believe it was that day. I mean, it's been years, so I can't right. tell you for sure.
Right.
But all I know is that when I then opened the Bible to those problem passages, I right. understood Matthew 24.
Right.
I understood 1 Thessalonians
and
5.
And you didn't before.
I didn't understand them in the context of which is right and which is wrong and right. how does it all fit together. Right now, every piece of the puzzle fits together
right.
and there's not one verse
right.
presently, there will be in the future,
right.
that I don't understand and I can't fit into the puzzle the way that it fits
right.
in the understanding of the end times.
Okay, so you went before the Lord and you were willing to be post-tribulation
Absolutely.
In your viewpoint.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Truth is most important.
So truth was most important. You didn't have an agenda.
No.
Okay, so here we are in the end times. I mean, you know, people say we're not in the end times. I personally think you need a psychiatrist.
Absolutely.
No, I'm not trying to make fun of anybody, but I personally think you need psychiatric help. And I know it sounds cruel. I don't mean it that way.
Can I quote a verse?
Yeah, okay. I mean, but just look at reality. I mean, the end times is everywhere. How can you say we're not in the end times?
Absolutely.
Go ahead, I'm sorry.
I'm sorry I interrupted, okay. but I want to give you the verse actually saying. In the last days, perilous times shall come. Men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, disobedient to parents. We've never had what we have in school system today. Unthankful, unholy, without natural affection. I believe what we see with children being aborted is unnatural affection for the child. That type of thing. Then in verse 7 of that comes ever learning and never able to come into knowledge of the truth.
Right. I'm going to just challenge you on one thing, not the whole thing. And the only reason I want to challenge it is for the sake of intellectual honesty and for people who might have questions. The Canaanites, they sacrificed their kids to Moloch and Baal and burned
sure.
them alive. So they had unnatural affection towards...
Oh, no doubt, no doubt.
So did the Israelites, though, when they backslid and worshiped Moloch and Baal. They had unnatural affection. So there has been unnatural affection.
Sure. The difference now is, okay. in the one I mentioned, I mean, there's right. a lot more that we could go deeper, but
right.
but I won't. In the essence here is you have people that are... You know, basically, they're not devil worshipers. These are church-going people. These are good people are making a decision that's unnatural affection.
I see. So
what
you're saying...
So it's not just the fringe. It's every day today.
Okay. So what you're saying is that this unnatural affection towards children has spread all to every... quarter of society,
right.
including the church.
Oh, sure.
It's dominated the church.
Yeah, let me say this. It doesn't mean that a person can't be forgiven for such
I'm
a
glad
sin.
You said that, right.
And I want to make sure that people understand that this isn't judgmental on that one specific group, because it's the only one I mentioned. It just means that it is unnatural.
Right.
And, you know, it's a shame that that's where we are, but, you know, in America, that's where we're going to be judged for those things. Can you imagine Sodom and Gomorrah being judged and then America not being judged because of the sin that we have? We will be. It doesn't mean that the individual that goes to God and sincerely repents of their sin and says, Lord, I need you to forgive my sins that they can't be forgiven because they can.
That's very important. And I just want to reiterate what Doug has said, and that is that no matter what sin you've committed, no matter what it is, and you may think it's unforgivable, but if you truly repent to the Lord and ask Him for forgiveness, no matter what you've done, Jesus Christ will cleanse you of your sin by His blood, and He will look at you as holy and righteous. He will look at you as if you have had never done it. So we're not here to place a burden of guilt and condemnation. You are just as accepted by God as some great evangelist like Billy Graham. In fact, and this is not in any disrespect towards Billy Graham, he is no more spiritual than you if once you've confessed your sin.
Sure.
Because it's the blood
of
Jesus.
Child of God.
Yes, amen. So you studied this and you see the times that we live in are, and you grasp on something. I mean, you said the behavior in schools. I'm not an expert in history, but I've studied history extensively. I cannot ever remember, Doug, a culture. I can't ever remember reading or studying about any culture, nation, or civilization that had what we have going on in our school systems openly and accepted by society. I can't think of one civilization throughout history which ever allowed what we consider normal.
Right. And unfortunately, it's going to get worse.
Right.
I mean, you know, we have in America, we've got this battle on, you know, bathrooms and things like that. And you know, the thing is, we've got to be concerned about all children, not just some that are confused, not just a segment of society, but we've got to be concerned about what's going to happen whenever people go into a restroom and they can't be stopped because they can just say, well, I identify with that sex. That's where we are today in our society. The thing is, we're spiraling down fast,
right.
And it's going to go faster.
And you're not saying, because people can sometimes misinterpret what's being said, you're not saying that none of us as Christians, we don't endorse calling people names and putting people down, no matter what their lifestyle or whatever. We're not called to attack and put people down.
No.
But you are saying we need to be concerned about everybody being protected.
Sure.
Not just a special group being protected, but everybody in society protected.
And the vulnerable ones are those not, I mean, yes, maybe it is that segment, that small segment, but the vulnerable ones are all children. So we have to look at those things and realize that they're opening Pandora's box, because if you have men that can go into a ladies' room, that's dangerous, because historically that's been a bad thing.
Well, yeah, I mean, historically, whenever you have a child, period, in any situation, with an adult, that child is by its nature powerless to defend him or herself, even verbally. So you see in our society the conditions that are unparalleled in human history.
Sure. And human history, I would say, okay, we've got some examples, and you mentioned them, where societies were very extreme. You know, they were sacrificing children on an altar and that type of thing. The problem with our society is that we are, you know, this nation was formed as a believing nation, whether they were Christians, they believed in God.
Right.
Historically, you look at the founding fathers,
right,
there they
are.
We are held more accountable because the Bible says, to whom much is given, much is required. So there's much required of us, much more than, you know, someplace. I've been in the jungles of Venezuela, much more than where I was in Venezuela. And we saw those groups evangelized en masse, but we have so much more understanding, and we have the Bible. And I don't know how many Bibles I have in my home, but you know, not like they do in the jungles of Venezuela. You know, they've been evangelized now, and it has helped. And but when you look at the situation, we're more accountable. That's
more
what
accountable.
I would say. Yes.
All right. So the so in your book, Reviving the Blessed Hope of Thessalonians, you're talking about the rapture. The rapture of the church before the tribulation, where the wrath of God is poured out in judgment, and horrific judgment, unparalleled judgment.
Absolutely.
Cataclysmic judgment. Your book talks about God's promise to deliver his people from the wrath to come.
Right.
That judgment. So what about between now and the rapture, as you see it? I mean, we're on the precipice in the U.S. and Europe, all across the world. It's just an absolute disaster about ready to break loose. And I feel sorry for Christians that are asleep, because disaster is going to, I mean, it's going to be unleashed. What about, how would you answer those people who say, you know, they talk about the persecution of the Chinese Christians and all. What about between now and the rapture? Where's God's protection between now and that blessed hope time?
Well, I think the only protection a person has is trusting in the Lord, as you do too. Mm-hmm. And we will, as Christians, before the rapture of the church, it's not an escapist doctrine. We're going to escape the tribulation, and therefore we don't believe that there's going to be a persecution or tribulation upon all of Christianity. It's going to be on all of Christianity. And we're not going to escape that persecution. How we trust in God will determine on how we handle it. In other words, if I'm at peace with God and I'm serving God and I love God, you're not going to be able to throw anything. I mean, we've had people burned at the stake that sang hymns during the thing. Hmm. How does that work? That's the protection of God.
All right, let's talk about that for 1 second. We're running out of time in this segment. But I've often been tortured by those thoughts of the apostles being burned alive or the martyrs being burned alive and wondering how they sang praises. Do you think at that moment God sent his spirit supernaturally on them?
And I think he anesthetized them. I mean, in other words, he gave them an anesthetic.
He supernaturally killed the pain.
Yes.
Because they didn't
feel a thing.
Okay, that makes me feel better because I'm telling you.
And that isn't just them. And
right.
That's the point.
Right.
So it isn't that God is going to do that for us.
Right.
But knowing that he can is
right.
Quite a comfort. So what I tell people is, look, here's what I tell people in the book.
Mm-hmm.
I say, live as though Jesus Christ is coming back today and plan as though you're going to grow old and die. That's the key. In other words, you got to plan like, if you need to protect your family, you need to have a plan.
Right.
That's very real. Because listen, this stuff that's going on around the world is going to come to America, and it
right.
has come to America, and it's going to get worse.
Right.
And they're going to clamp down on all people, take away freedoms and liberties in order to protect us from this calamity. And in doing so, they're going to persecute believers, Christians, they're going to persecute Jews, they're going to persecute anybody that aligns themselves with the God of the Bible. And that's coming. And that's before, I believe, before the rapture of the church.
Okay, so those were a sober addendum to the blessed hope. It doesn't diminish the blessed hope.
No.
And we're going to talk more with Doug about the blessed hope and how it relates to this present time, because God did not promise us immunity from trials and tribulations of this world. He has promised to supernaturally protect us. My guest was hit by a train, and he was supernaturally spared. Not everybody is supernaturally spared.
No.
Some people are hit by trains and they go on to be to heaven, assuming they've accepted Christ as their Lord. So I want to encourage you to walk with Jesus Christ and have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, because he's really your ultimate protection. And he is a rock which you can depend on. And he is the solid rock. And it's only by standing on the solid rock that you and I can have supernatural protection. I'm Paul McGuire. You're watching Apocalypse and the End Times here on God TV.